suddenly became really famous, and all of a sudden we've got these backyard ultras all around the world, and there's dozens and dozens of them. And you know what format's going to come next? There'll be, I'm sure Laz has got a whole load of other crazy ones, and then other people will come up with something suitably crazy.
Kia ora everyone, that was Chris Hope. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
And this is Dirt Church Radio, interesting conversations with interesting runners. Chorus watches. Apparently, they've got a new model coming out that lasts 463 years in full GPS mode.
That's a bit longer than their last one, but not by much, because that's what they do. They last and last.
Apparently, this watch will give you daily affirmations. It will count your steps for you. It'll align your chakra. It's got Vert in there. No, it doesn't. But look, Chorus watches are really good. They've got amazing battery life. Is the Vertex like 60 hours in full GPS or something like that? Do you remember your first ever GPS watch? It was like that glove that Thanos wore, and it burned your hand, and it had a battery life of 1 hour.
And you had to run with your hand in the ear.
Yeah, that's right. Chorus watches aren't like that.
No.
But if you go to chorus.co.nz, you get 10% off with the code LOCAL. And Chorus watches have been a long-time sponsor of Dirt Church Radio, and we love them. So chorus.co.nz.
You know what else is local, Matt?
No.
Wild Things. So Wild Things is as local as it gets in New Zealand, isn't it?
It is. And I was actually talking to Wild Things impresario Malcolm Law the other day, and talking about how at the moment community is really important.
Yeah.
And it seems like Wild Things is really important to a lot of people.
Well, it fosters community, doesn't it? It's what it's all about.
It does.
It's also about things like, you know, their amazing trail directory.
Yes.
They're now figuring out a way of chasing FKTs on trails.
Huh.
Yeah. So it's for the grunty trails, and they're working out in the background with this amazing computer technology, or possibly, you know, I don't know, using, I don't know where I'm going with that. But
I mean, what my thing is, so it's a grunt factor of 15 or more. What's one grunt?
It's like a grunt.
And do you get like a semi-grunt or a demi-grunt?
Or a semi-grunt? You have to take the full grunt to be able to qualify. So 15 of them. So some of these trials, so the trials that have a grunt factor of 15 or more, they're going to have an FKT availability, if you call it that.
Yeah.
But to be able to qualify, you know, to register an FKT, you need to be a paid up member of Wild Things, a VIP member, and you need to sync your Strava account to it. Well, the Strava account, you can do that yourself. But with the VIP membership, we're here to help, aren't we?
Yeah, we are.
Yeah. So if you use the code DCR2020, you can get 15 months of Wild Things membership for the price of 12. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Because maths.
And if anyone can explain to me what a unit, maybe Gareth Morris could, what one grunt is, please do write to me.
Yeah.
I'm at room 413 of the Hilton in central Auckland. Just address it to Matt Raymond and send it right in, and you'll get a prize.
That's some bubble.
Yep. wildthings.club/register. We've got a jingle for Further Faster. We should probably just play that.
Which one is it?
It's the Further Faster jingle.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know it was Badger the Dog's 40th birthday last week?
Oh, we should have had a happy birthday jingle.
Yeah, yeah. Further Faster is New Zealand's foremost indie outdoors store, and in Level 3, Rocky, Badger and Dan are back in store filling orders and doing contactless pickups, as well as sending things out across hill and dale with the good men and women of New Zealand Post. We love Further Faster. They have supported us for a long time, and they're amazing. independent outdoors retailer. Go to furtherfaster.co.nz and check them out.
And it goes something like further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Ditchitch Radio.
Here we are again.
Episode 92.
We made it.
Are we going to sing the whole thing? Why don't we sing the whole thing, operatic?
Why not? What else? Have you not learned a language while you've been in lockdown, learned how to sing opera?
Let's jump the shark. Yeah, we made it. Goodness, times fly.
Ah, it does, eh? It feels interminably long, but well done, everyone. And we've got a really interesting conversation with a gentleman who we've both known for a long time, you know, been around the traps, Chris Running Calendar Hope.
Yeah.
He's
got a great
owner of Running Calendar, which is like the Australasian trail and running almanac, dense resource. And
if you want to burn like, you know, hours and hours and hours just sit there having a look at how many events are on that thing. Holy moly.
Yeah, amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
He's got a great overview of races and trends. Yeah. And we talked to him about all of that, plus his own running journey as well.
Yeah. And I won't spoil the greatest run ever, but the last 10 kilometers of that greatest run ever were locked in a perhaps what you might call a ding-dong battle with yours truly.
Yeah, see, when he submitted his greatest run ever, I do remember that about it. And then when he spoke about it, anyway, keep listening, people.
I was quiet. But yeah, that was amazing. Amazing, amazing memories. So
yeah.
Yeah, wow. What a week. Here we are. We're still in our bedrooms.
We are. Lockdown life continues. Hey, I was thinking about your conversation with Vlad Chatrov, you know, a machine. And he just sort of casually dropped in that he'd love to come and do Kepler.
I know.
Imagine that.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah.
Sheesh.
Yeah. I mean, I guess in terms of races too, we're kind of salivating over the fact because like so many races are now cancelled, postponed. Good reason to do that.
Yeah. Totally.
But Kepler is, for all intents and purposes, going ahead. And, you know, wouldn't it be amazing if we've got a trans-Tasman bubble and you've got like Vlad Chatrov and... Oh, I wonder if Martin Dent's 2013 record of 4:33.37 would fall.
He'd certainly have a good nudge at it, wouldn't he?
I think he would.
Yeah.
We'll need to see what shakes out.
We certainly will. Yeah. Hey, speaking of running and training,
yes,
because that's what we're about,
yes,
in a running podcast.
Yes.
You've been talking to some people about a particularly exciting development that's about to happen or has happened.
Yeah, and it's really interesting. I don't know if it's a random universe or things happen at the right moment. I mean, I've just been struggling with motivation and struggling with purpose and where the running comes from and, you know, where to from here and structure. And Vert.Run, which is an online training platform for trail and ultras, have just launched a brand new training plan made by the one and only Ruth Croft. And Ruth's plan is designed for athletes who want to train for a 60K, 70K or 80K race, and specifically for athletes who are stuck in cities without daily trail access, which for a lot of people in New Zealand and Australia is a lot of people, I guess, because everyone's kind of locked down and everyone's getting a bit antsy. Her plans are $6 a week, and that includes, you know, check-in with the coaches at Vert.Run. And it's really cool. Like, I had a look on their site. You know, Hillary Allen's done stuff. Dylan Bowman's done stuff. All sorts of really amazing athletes. And their mission is to bring the high of trail running to everyone, everywhere. They offer free training plans and partner with pro athletes like Ruth to make smart, safe training accessible. And they've given us a discount code. So if you'd like to have a look at Ruth's plan, which drops tomorrow, or no, actually, it'll drop in the future. I always do this because we don't drop it now. If you're listening to this on Wednesday, and I'm sorry for the preamble, and it'll already have come out. But the code is DirtChurch10, and you get $10 off the plan,
pretty cool.
Which is a 14-week plan. Yeah, so cool. Check it out, and they're at Vert.Run.
Cool, and then you just go and find Ruth Croft, and suddenly, like, you get Ruth Croft running with you. Basically, it's what it kind of, you know, sort of feel like.
I've signed up for it.
Have you?
Yeah, I have.
Which what's this going to entail, Matt?
It's 14 weeks of virtually Ruth Croft, just, you know, being like the frightening rabbit from Donnie Darko. I'm picking.
14 weeks. Let's follow this because it's going to be interesting.
I'll turn into Ruth Croft.
You could do. Watch out, Old Ghost Road.
Watch out, Martin Gaffari.
Well, there is that. You should basically, you know, like, if there wasn't the lockdown problems, you could have gone to UTMB Festival, but, you know, and been people asking for your autograph and stuff.
Could have won CCC, all that stuff. But I am actually really excited about this. I know it sounds like this is obviously something that they've approached us and we've like, let's do this together because this is amazing. But I'm really excited for the next 14 weeks to kind of get back on the trolley. And it's always fun doing a challenge. And
Go for it. Whoop, whoop. How have you been? Apart from being excited to be turning into Ruth Croft, how have you been?
Well, if last week was a low point, then this week's been the climb back out the hole, you know? Mm-hmm. And the thing that I keep coming back to again and again is, thank goodness we live where we live, that largely we're okay, and that as hard as it's been, it could have been harder. It was my sister's birthday on Friday, you know, and as I said on last week's podcast, you know, she was really, really sick, and we were chatting.
With, for those of you who didn't know,
with
she
COVID-19.
Had, with COVID, yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, there's only me and her. She's my younger sister. And I said that, you know, I said, like, this probably wasn't the manner in which she envisaged spending her 40th birthday. And she said something really just very matter-of-factly, that she was happy to be having a birthday at all because she didn't expect to live to see her 40th birthday, which was really quite confronting.
Let that sink in.
Yeah. But that's it, right? Like, just that profound sense of, if she can be grateful for that, I can be grateful for my health, and I can be grateful for my family's health, and I can be grateful for the inconvenience of this lockdown because I'm healthy and my family healthy and you're healthy, and you know what I mean? So I feel like it's just that reminder, that perspective's been really, really important. I've got some fun stuff I've started to plan again with running. I've got some fun stuff I want to do. I went for a big run on the Saturday, and boy, my legs are pretty sore on the Sunday. But it was really nice to actually feel that again, you know? So things are looking up.
That's good. That's so good to hear, because lots of people were worried about you and your sister and stuff. So that's really good to hear.
And what about you, man? How have you been?
Yeah, I was kind of, you know, as we've been getting towards, hopefully, if people stop having parties and going to the beach and stuff, getting towards level two, sort of been looking back on, you know, what we can take out of this that's positive. I've had some really lovely family moments during lockdown. It's been really nice, actually. So you sort of start to think about some of the things that you want to carry on with out of this lockdown life. But to be honest, in my running life, I feel a bit weird, to be honest. I was all set to drive out, and we talked about this on Saturday. I was all set to drive out on Sunday for a run, return to the trails, you know, and I was really looking forward to it. But then I saw pictures of heaps of people going out to trailheads all over the place on Saturday, all over the country, mountain bikes and stuff. And I kind of freaked out. And I, you know, we were talking about this on Saturday, weren't we, where I said, how was it out there? And you said it was really busy, but people were being good and everything. But even so, it just kind of freaked me out. I was all ready to go on Sunday morning. I got everything ready the night before so that I could get up early and go. It's just a 15-minute drive to the forest. But then I just slept really badly. I had physical distancing nightmares, which sounds weird, but I did.
It doesn't sound weird at all.
And then I woke up in the morning, I just sort of chickened out, really. I just went for a run from home. And then all day I was just kind of grumpy with myself because it doesn't make sense on so many levels. You know, I'm allowed to. There wasn't any rules that were being broken. But I don't know. It just, the whole thing kind of brings out the worst sort of scaredy cat tendencies in me.
I think it probably, if you reframe that, it probably brings out your sense of duty and your sense of sort of thinking about other people and the whole thing about the etiquette of doing something. I know for myself, going for a run on Saturday, you know, and I went out for like, and again, it's not as far as many people run, but like I went out for like 24 kilometers, and it was the first time since level 4 had been lifted that I felt comfortable. I felt socially comfortable doing it.
Yeah.
You know, and I'd even said to you, hey, come park down on my verge. And for those who, you know, don't know, it wouldn't be breaking any bubbles. I absolutely, as much as I want to see Eugene, wouldn't have come down. I've got a steep driveway. It's not like him, you know, impinging on anything. And you could have socially distanced, ran to the forest, which is 500 meters away, and there we go. But it's understandable.
Yeah, yeah. It just, you know, just was. But anyway, as I talked about last week, you know, after 4 weeks of trying to do speed work and getting slower, last week I kind of went back to base building, and I'll take a couple of weeks to slowly build up because I want to keep on top of those niggles that I've got control of during lockdown. Got my own a few things, maybe, I don't know. And I guess we'll see what the future holds, but I'm just glad to be out running, to be healthy, that my family is well, you're well, you know, it's life is good considering.
And for our listeners, I have no idea what he's talking about either. Cause the man keeps his cards close to his chest. And I don't know.
Well, partly it's like, what's going to be on?
Exactly. No, I'm being silly. Yeah. It's, but I love that. I love it. I'm stoked. All right, man, hit the red button.
Boom.
Stuff you should know.
Boom. I'm going to rip this idea straight off James Kugler because he posted it on Facebook on Sunday and I thought it was so good. Because as well as having those social distancing nightmares, I was listening to the rain and the wind all night on Saturday night. And when you've got a run planned for the morning, the easiest thing to do when you hear all that stuff is just to hit the alarm, go back to sleep, right? And I've been there. Sometimes I've even done that. But James had some great advice. He said, put your shoes on. And this was, he posted this on early on Saturday morning when people, Sunday morning, sorry, when people would have been getting up and going, might go back to sleep.
Is it raining? Yeah.
Yeah. He said, put your shoes on, maybe a jacket, step out the door. If after 10 minutes, it's as bad as your 2 a.m. brain thought it was going to be, turn around and go home. Hint, it probably isn't that bad. Word, you know, there's only one time I've actually gone back. It was in the middle of a horrendous thunderstorm, and I figured since I was the only person out there, my chance of getting hit by lightning were pretty high. So I scooted back home, which by that stage was about 3K, and I don't think I've run 3K as fast as I have in my life that time. But what's the worst conditions you've run in, Matt?
Well, I was thinking about this, and I was, because I saw what James had put, and you know, have being an old coaching client of James, that's one of the things that he says all the time. Give it 10 minutes, and if it's terrible after 10 minutes, you can turn back, and it never is.
Yeah.
And I was out running yesterday in the forest, and it was pouring down really heavily. And I was thinking about, well, no, this is nowhere near the worst conditions I've run in. And you know, because we live in Auckland, you don't have the kind of the Terry Davis kind of Northburn story where that person was like completely half covered in snow, or and we don't live in Australia, so there's not snakes and crocodiles and dingoes and God knows what else, wherever, mountain lions or bears. But it was in Riverhead, and it was on a Sunday night, and I'd gone out to run something that we call the DCMF half. It's a 21-kilometer gravel route, a loop, and I was right out the back coming up this, it's about a three-kilometer climb called Anzac Road, and middle of the night with the dog, having great fun, really mellow run, and a massive lightning storm struck up, and we were right overhead. You know, and the lightning, like I could smell it. The sky was going like sort of yellow and purple and blue, and what? And I was so frightened because it was like I've never been closer. And like you said, I got home pretty quickly. Yeah. Like I think I set, you know, I think I got a crown or PR certainly on some sections. And but the weather got so bad that, you know, we came up over Longbush Road, that the dog was huddled against my legs going, no way, I'm not going. And I don't remember if that was the same run, but at points too, it was so foggy, I had to turn my headlamp off. because the reflected light was blinding.
Yeah.
So it was easier to run. Yeah.
Yes.
But,
man.
Yeah, it was all good fun. You know, you sort of get home and you go, oh, I feel alive.
Well, you know, you mentioned Terry, you know, it's, you know, like you say, like he says, you're not alive until you get out and run in a storm.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What's your, I mean, we've talked about yours, but it'd be interesting if people could send in there.
Yeah, send them in.
Southern hard people, shame us with your...
Exactly.
Shame us with your frost beards.
Yeah, well, Auckland has got a bit of rain. I have had frostbite, not frostbite, sorry. I got, I ran in a southerly storm in Wellington once and got back, and I remember going to open the door and I couldn't because my hands were blue, my lips were blue, and I was pretty close to hypothermic, if not hypothermic. That was cold.
You've got an amazing beard. Have you ever had a frost beard?
No.
Oh, you've never had the icicles going on?
No, I haven't. I was thinking whether I did when I ran in the States once in snow, but no, I had just a bit of snow on the thing, but not like that. Yeah, but yeah, that's a good idea. If you have run in horrific conditions, send them in, even if they're not your greatest friend ever. We'd love to hear about it.
Damn right.
Yeah.
So the moral of the story listen to your 2 a.m. brain.
Yeah, that's it. That's a good moral of the story. The other, speaking of tough conditions and the race last year, Kepler.
So as we said at the top, it's all going ahead, hopefully. Yep. Of the 2020 event, and the email has come through in a reminder of just what that community's been through in the last 6 months. I mean, Tiano, it's a town that runs on tourism, and they'll be suffering at the moment. And you know, that the course change, Kepler, the third time.
Yeah,
they had to do the alternate course. Yep. So it's been a hell of a six months.
They had that enormous storm not long afterwards, did they? Was it at the beginning of the year where they had to, the Milford Road was closed, the whole region was in a lockdown for a state of emergency at least for a couple of weeks.
Mm.
You know, and now this. So
yeah,
they've copped it, haven't they?
Yeah, so, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's a real, as you've put, it's a total kick in the slats. I mean, it really is.
Yeah.
Look, and you know, we're going to be there. We fully intend to be there. And Saturday, December 5th, if we can get in, and we'll be there. Yeah. And on that note.
Yeah. So, I mean, as they mentioned last week, you know, we'd heard that it's going to be back to the first come, first served entry online system, that, you know what I mean, after the trial of the ballot system last year. And the committee says even in the current climate, it seems... You know, when it seems that the international field is unlikely to be around because of the border restrictions, maybe with Australia there, hopefully. But they're still expecting it to be a sellout. So get on your laptop, get on your phone, get on your home PTC. Yeah, absolutely. And get there because it's a great race, isn't it? So
absolutely.
Yeah, but look, people have still been doing plenty of lockdown virtual runs.
Lazarus Lake.
Hey, I can. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Absolutely.
I want to be buddies with Lazarus Lake just so I get a really cool nickname.
Yeah.
Bad Mike.
Yeah.
Danger Dave.
Yeah. Derb.
Derb. Raw Dog. Frozen Ed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's he doing? What's he up to now?
Well, there's the 1,000-kilometer Great Virtual Road Race across Tennessee. I've been watching Dave Proctor do like his 4 minute 57, you know, 100K, 4 minute 57 average 100K runs across virtual Tennessee.
Wow.
But they've put together this virtual race. It's 1,000 kilometers across Tennessee from the very southwestern tip of the state to the very northeastern tip of the state. And they have a map set up showing your daily progress. And they get a link and they can record the daily mileage, update the map and standings. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good idea.
Wow. God. I mean, and you've got the whole American summer, haven't you? The whole northern summer from May 1st to August 31st to complete, which is 5 miles a day. Or as they say, why not do an out and back? There's just no edges there. I've been thinking, because I've been noticing all these events and they seem to be getting more and more and more extreme.
Yep.
When's someone going to do the Proclaimers Challenge?
I would walk 500 miles.
Yeah, run 500 miles, then run 500 miles again just to be the runner who ran 1,000 miles.
And then fell down
at the door.
Yeah, and you could put a really creepy twist on it where you could, that could be the way that you voice your love to your crush.
Could be.
You'd have to plan it. You'd have to time it. But anyway,
yep.
Moving on to greatest run ever, which is, as you know, the part of the show where we ask you to write in and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. It might just be a run around the block, something that's sung to you for some reason. You could send it into us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And this is from Peter Armstrong. Hey, guys, I love listening to your podcast, and I don't think I've missed many over the last few years. Thanks for your effort on this, and keep up the good work. Thank you very much. It's difficult to pick up one, but I'm going to go with the Crater Ultra 53-kilometer last year. Having had surgery on both knees throughout my 30s to deal with meniscus tears, I'd been told by an orthopedic surgeon that I should stop running completely, basically give up, and expect a knee replacement in 10 years. What do they know? Well, as you guys know, running is pretty addictive, and as such, I kind of just kept going and found some ways actually to train properly, found a great running doctor. He gives the link, runningmedicine.co.nz for Dr. John Malloy. Little side note,
yeah.
John Malloy was a house officer when I was a clinical nurse specialist at Rotorua Hospital.
Yes. And you guys bumped into each other at Kepler.
And Wutuke.
It was Wutuke, yeah.
I ran with him. And when I did my first ever off-road marathon at the 32K aid station, when I thought I was going to faint, I saw John come in and I was like, oh, good, John's here because I'll pass out near him because he's a doctor. I had it all planned out. Yeah. Anyway. There you go. And John Malloy is the founder of the Four Paws Marathon in Christchurch.
He is too. That's right.
Amazing. And he's a lovely human being. But anyway, this isn't the John Malloy Church Radio. This is Dirt Church Radio. So Dr. John Malloy, who helped me understand that running is actually therapeutic if done properly, and it's put in brackets here, I wish I'd cared more about my core when I was younger. And it culminated in running the Crater Ultra and then the inaugural Valley Ultra a month later. It was amazing to get into ultra mode, albeit a mini ultra, and spend an amazing day on the trails with a whole bunch of friendly, interesting people. I was joined about the 40K mark by my sister and her daughter, who helped keep me going to the finish line and then eventually crossed the line with my kids. My family was there supporting me, and the feeling of emotion and satisfaction and achievement was like nothing I'd ever experienced. Best run ever, but I reckon there's even better ones coming. Thanks, Peter.
I bet there are.
That crater rim sounds sick.
Yeah, definitely got to get there, don't we?
Yeah. Right.
We definitely need to get there. Right.
On to our main interview, and first thing we have to say is there are some atmospheric conditions happening, which, it was raining really heavily at times during the interview. So just, that noise is.
Yeah, it's not a monster. It's growling in the
tearing
background.
Tearing off the roof of Eugene's house. It's just the rain. Chris Hope is the owner and founder of Running Calendar. And that's runningcalendar.co.nz and runningcalendar.com.au. And it pretty much is the main resource for all things running in Australasia. He started it himself and has built up this incredible resource. And we have an amazing talk to him about what the future of racing is in the short term in Australasia, how things are going, where things have come. We do a bit of a deep dive into trends around racing and talk to him about his own trail and ultra running career. He's a passionate trail runner, and it was a really amazing conversation. So without further ado, Chris Hope.
Church Radio. So joining us on the line is Chris Hope, probably better known as Mr. Running Calendar. Welcome to the show, Chris, all the way from Auckland.
Thank you.
The exotic location. But of course, with our social distancing, we're all in separate parts of Auckland, aren't we?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you in your bedroom, Chris?
No, I have a small office off our hallway, and I'm sitting in there now, and all the family have been instructed not to come anywhere near me.
We've run with Chris at Riverhead many times, and in our exchange of setting up this chat, we sort of thought that we talked about how, one day when we did this, we'd probably go for a run and then have a chat, but it hasn't worked out that way, has it?
Yeah, that's what I always thought. I sort of had in my head that I'd drive out and see you guys and we'd have a nice run together and then we'd be able to do an actual face-to-face interview. But I suppose it's a bit different now, isn't it?
Yeah.
Certainly is.
Yeah. So running calendar is quite a phenomenon. And I guess we should start by just maybe if you could just explain for people who aren't aware, what is it and, you know, what's it, you know, what's its primary use? What should people use it for?
Sure. So basically, it's the most comprehensive list of running events in Australia and New Zealand. And there's also anything running related. So we've got triathlons, duathlons, anything that's got some element of running. So adventure racing and multi-sport as well. Basically, there's a really comprehensive search function. So you can, you know, search up, like if you wanted to find half marathons in a particular region, it's really easy to find them. If you want trail events, you can find those really easily. There's all sorts of searching criteria.
And, I mean, it's quite, running is so, all those events are quite disparate, you know, organised by different people. It's all over, scattered all over the place. How do you sort of pull it all together?
Okay, so when I started out, so I started 10 years ago, so the 10th birthday was about 2 or 3 weeks ago, and when I first started, it was really hard to find information about running events. There was a website in New Zealand called Cool Running, and it was just a one-page list of events. Yeah, and you'd have to you'd look on there, but then you still have to go searching on Google or whatever to see what else you could find. And I'm a website programmer, and was a keen runner, so I figured I should put something together myself. And so I realised that starting as a new website, no event organiser is going to know who I am and what my website is, so they're not going to come along and tell me what the events are. So I figured I had to go out and find them all myself. And the only way to keep a really comprehensive list of events was to keep monitoring websites and, you know, look out for all the events and basically keep it all up to date myself. And so that's how it still works now. I keep an eye out on all the events, looking for new ones, looking for new dates, making all the updates that I need to. And basically I spend a huge amount of time keeping it up to date myself.
I mean, I'm looking at running calendar as we speak. It is truly comprehensive. Like I'm just scrolling and scrolling and scrolling and scrolling. And I think I'm about 2 weeks in the future. I mean,
yeah.
Is this a full-time gig for you?
Not quite. It's probably, 20 to 30-hour a week job, keeping it up to date. And that's both countries, so that's New Zealand and Australia. And obviously there are a lot more events in Australia. But, you know, I'm always looking out for, you know, especially at the moment, because everything's being postponed or cancelled. And I was actually finding it a bit annoying today trying to find the ones that weren't. So I added a new filter onto the site so you can now exclude postponed and cancelled events. So it's a little bit easier to see what's coming up. I spend all the time doing that. And also I do a lot of new programming and stuff on it all the time. So there's a lot of stuff that goes on behind the scenes that you can't really see. And then I try and add new features as and when I can.
Wow. I mean, and on that, I mean, this whole bloody COVID-19, I mean, so many races looking on your site are cancelled or postponed. I mean, you must really feel for both the race directors and the participants, hey?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, for all of us, I mean, I work for a couple of different running events companies as well as event crew. So I work on the day, you know, doing all sorts. We set up the event base, course marking, setting up aid stations, all that sort of stuff. And so we had done the Maraetai half marathon. And at the start of the weekend was when they first put the border restrictions. No, they were announced the border restrictions. So they were saying that on Sunday night, if you come to the country, you have to go into self-isolation for 14 days. And I was like, oh, you can't do that. You know, you're going to kill the tourism industry. And then by Monday, I totally come around. I'm like, you can't let them into the country. Forcefully quarantine them. No. And we go for like drinks and have a late lunch after we finish pack down. And we were like, we had another running event following weekend, Run Albany. And we're like, oh, that'll probably go ahead. And then we have the waterfront half marathon 3 weeks later. And we're like, oh, that might be a little bit iffy. And then, you know, by middle of that week, we knew we weren't doing either of those because it was no events greater than 500 people. And then the following week, we're in lockdown. So, you know, it all changed very quickly. And so I could see exactly what's going on with these people. And I know so many of the event organisers myself personally. It's just really hard watching this happening. You know, and you're seeing these event companies, you know, struggling to stay afloat, really.
Mm-hmm. It is. It's, you know, it's, yeah, we were just talking about it off air, weren't we, Matt, about that sort of impact that's happening and, you know, none more so than in the events circle. What are you hearing in terms of what, you know, how people are getting by and what their thinking is around when we might get racing again and what that might look like?
Yeah, so I know that the government wage subsidy that we had has certainly helped a lot of businesses. Yeah. Aaron Carter from Total Sport wrote this really great post about, you know, how it affected them and what steps they did to try and alleviate things. And it was pretty much, they were struggling to, at first it was like, oh, let's see if we can still put this event on. And then it was like, next day, oh, no, we can't. The goalposts kept changing pretty much every day. So suddenly people are like, oh, this is postponed. And then the realization that all these other events are being postponed. So when are we going to put them on? And now so many events that have had dates announced are in sort of September, October. And like there's a particular weekend, I think it's the 19th and 20th of September, which is now packed full of events. And then I think it's the Rotorua Marathon the following weekend. So, and then there's this sort of flow-on effect. So I saw one event in Australia is now probably going to get cancelled because UTA was moved onto the date their event was on. So you get some events being pushed back and that pushes back other events or cancels those ones. So there's a real domino effect sort of happening at the moment. Yeah.
Everyone's trying to plan for when we might get back. So you think that, well, from what you're seeing, event organisers are looking at September, October. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I think that's sort of been where a lot of them have been trying to put them because, August, September, October, definitely. I mean, if you were trying to say June's your new date, well, you know, we don't really know. It's too soon and we don't know if they're going to be in place. And the other thing is there's, if we go into level two in the next couple of weeks, then we can have events of, you can have 500 people outdoors. That number is like everyone. So it doesn't mean you can suddenly let 500 people into your race because if you think about where the start line is, you've got participants, you've got their supporters, you've got event room and all that sort of stuff. And that all adds up to that number.
Yeah.
So smaller events are going to be able to, you know, work within level two fairly easily with, you know, maybe some different rules in place. Like maybe they don't have a briefing at the start or they try and get your supporters to stay away or I don't know. but then if we go to level one at some point, then we've still got travel restrictions. And so you've got some events where, things like Tauira, there's Ironman 70.3 World Champs in November, I think. And they both have, you know, there'll be a lot of international participants. And if we're still not out of that by then, it's going to really affect those events. And if they like, you know, if we go into level one and Australians are allowed to come here, then I think then most running events are still going to be okay because most of them, the overseas participants are from Australia.
Yeah.
But you get stuff like, the world champs, you know, Ironman, you know, there's going to be people coming from everywhere for that, but there's a fairly good chance that there'll be, you know, still be travel restrictions at that point in time.
Mm. Are you hearing anything? You mentioned potential other things that races might do to try to mitigate risk, but are you hearing anything or seeing anything coming through of what steps they might take? You know, I don't know, aid stations, race briefings, those sorts of things, making changes that mean that there's less risk?
Yeah, no, I haven't really seen that anywhere other than you guys talking about, through the lolly jar, you know. I think I might have seen some things about, you know, you know how trail running is going towards cup free anyway. Like there's very few trail events that have cups at all. Even when they're cup free, like I know the total sport events, they usually have cups at the aid stations, but I think that'll just be gone entirely. It's a bit trickier for the road running events, because road runners are so used to having the water on the course. And, you know, when you've got an event where you might have 2,500 people, it's quite hard to try and suddenly change their mindset. But maybe, who knows, maybe some of those will start to expect people to wear, you know, bring their own water with them. Not really sure. But coming back to what they might be doing, so there was one event called Rotorua Suffer, which is a triathlon, and that's in November, December. I think it's on the last day of November and the first day of December. And that was originally a one-day event, but he's decided, even though it's this far out, he's going to make it a two-and-a-half-day event and have the fun run on the Friday night and have one of the triathlons on Saturday, another triathlon on Sunday, just so he makes sure with his planning now that he knows he's going to be within, you know, the 500 limits.
Right.
That's still, yeah, if that's still in place then. So he's really, really far ahead.
That's it's a whole new way of kind of thinking about it. Hey, going from these condensed events to almost this sort of festival vibe, and you've seen that, you know, Tarawera's tried to accomplish it. There was a race festival in Tasmania and through Europe and that. One of the things I wanted to kind of pick your brain about while we had you here is, you know, because you're so tapped into, I guess, trends in Australasia or globally in terms of racing and trail racing specifically, where had you seen things going in regards to trail runs and races? Like, have you noticed a shift from either towards ultra distance or away from or different formats? What's been popular or what is becoming popular?
Yeah, okay. So when I first started, ultramarathons were, no, they definitely existed, but there weren't a huge number of them. And even in New Zealand, like, there weren't that many marathons. Like, there was this guy, this runner I knew, and one year he set out to run every single marathon in New Zealand, which meant he pretty much had to run a marathon every weekend. Some weekends he'd get off, some weekends he might have to do two. But there were, like, maybe 25, 26 then. That's just marathons. And now there'll be a lot more than that. And the ultramarathons, they're really picked up. There's definitely a lot more trail running events. And there's a lot more events in general. Like, I'm finding, like in New Zealand, and just recently there's a lot of event companies now in Christchurch. And so there's this, like, real massive number of events at Christchurch. Probably after Auckland, I think there'd be more there than anywhere else in the country. And so you've got these new event companies coming up, all these new events. So just more of everything. And it's almost at a saturation point in certain parts of New Zealand. And that's just, you know, all running. And definitely a lot more trail running. I think when people discover trail running, I think they find it, it's in some ways more enjoyable. There's not the same pressures to try and run, you know, a fast, consistent pace. And you get out and enjoy nature a bit more. So it's more about the journey rather than the race, if you know what I mean.
Mm.
Other trends, what happened a few years ago, there's a real thing for themed runs. So, you know, like colour runs where they throw colour at you as you run around the course. And then there's been, like, obstacle course racing has obviously become very big. And then there's, like, foam runs. Foam runs. In Australia there was a series of inflatable, you know, it was an inflatable obstacle course. So there's all these crazy things. And then the colour runs have kind of died off a little bit. But the obstacle course racing is still really big. And they're trying to create this bigger national movement with international championships. And they'll be trying to get it into the Olympics and all that sort of stuff. There's a whole variety of different sort of events. You know, whatever you want to do, there's some way of doing running with it.
There's a niche for everyone. I remember Nicodemus Holland, who won Tour de Giant, and he was a Barclay finisher. He started doing these really sort of super far out Spartan races in the US. And, you know, like, it was the one that, like, you had to make your own sandals You know, that was the first thing you had to do before. And then you had to carry like a log for 200 miles. Like, it was just so wacky. I mean, I guess if there's a niche, humans will fill it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think what's quite fascinating is the backyard ultra format. You know, from my understanding, like, Laz has been doing it for like 20 years. And then the only reason why the world suddenly knew about it was because it was she didn't win it that year, did she? Whichever one it was. But suddenly, because this woman almost won it, it was Courtney. It suddenly became really famous, and all of a sudden we've got these backyard ultras all around the world, and there's dozens and dozens of them. And you know what format's going to come next? You know, there'll be. I mean, I'm sure Laz has got a whole load of other crazy ones, and then other people will come up with something suitably crazy. I mean, you get crazy people here in New Zealand, like the Cross Chicago guys, and then there's the Blue Lake 24 Hour, they've got a spa at the start finish area.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, I think so. I was looking at their Facebook page today, and they're sitting in a spa beside the Blue Lake.
I mean, do you think you'll see the rise of, you know, the ultra distance events? You know, think about, you know, the Tahoe 200 and stuff like that. Do you think there's a place for that in Australasia?
Yeah, well, there was a 500 kilometer race in the Gold Coast last year, and there was I don't think it's being run this year, but there was a 6-day race in Adelaide, and there's the multi-day stage races. So, you know, there was Alps to Ocean, which is finished now, but another one has taken its place, and it's also in the South Island. So, you know, you race for like a week and you do round about a marathon every day. And then one day there's a really long distance, which you take 2 days to do. And I think there's a real niche for those sorts of events. Like, you might only get maybe a couple of hundred people, but there's definitely niches for everyone. And 200 miles seems to be the new 100 mile for some of those people.
Naseby has a 200 mile, well, we're supposed to, yeah, if true. It goes ahead for this year, doesn't it? And there's a bit of a tradition in Australia too, isn't there? There was the Sydney to Melbourne for years that would go on down the road. God, I'm kind of struggling to remember the farmer who used to win it every year, turn up, and the potato farmer.
Well, he wore gumboots, and everyone laughed at him, but he basically didn't sleep, and I think he pretty much shuffled the whole way, and then he went and won.
Just kept going. Yeah. Sorry, I just can't move on without going back to the colour runs and you saying that they died. Ha ha. Sorry.
Oh no, they're still there, but I don't know what's happened in Australia.
Yeah.
They used to be a lot of them, and then there were three of them, and I don't quite know what's happening over there. Yeah. And there's still one here. I don't think next year's date's been scheduled, but it's still around. There's just not many.
There's not many, but they used to be. Sorry.
Yeah. I mean, there's this other company. Like, there's a few of them in Australia, because there's the Colour Run, and then there's everyone else who does them. Mm. And there's quite a few other ones in Australia. But those thing ones tend to come and go a bit. And I've often seen a trend where you can tell when they're struggling to get entries in, because about 2 weeks before the event, they're like, yeah, tickets, you know, come in and get your tickets, quick, blah, blah. And then 2 days later, sorry, the event's been cancelled due to unforeseen circumstances.
Yeah, it's a bit like concerts, isn't it? But what do you notice in terms of differences between Australia and New Zealand? Obviously, one is population size, but do you notice anything in terms of what's happening, obviously pre-COVID, with racing in Australia versus New Zealand?
I've been having a think about this for the last couple of weeks, and I don't think there's really too much difference apart from the size. You know, so there's five times the population, and so there's and a much more dense population clusters. So you can get some really big events, like the top sort of seven or eight events in Australia, or just running events, all have at least 20,000 people. Like the biggest one has 80,000, and then so the biggest.
What's that?
It is the. Hang on, I'm just going to have to look it up. I can't. If I try and remember off the top of my head, I will get it wrong. It's the Sun Herald City to Surf.
City to Surf, right? Yep.
Yeah. But whereas in New Zealand, you know, I think Round the Bays gets maybe like 20,000. Auckland Marathon, over all the events, apparently something like 15. And then it drops down to, you know, like the 3,000 or 4,000 for a few events. So the bigger events are bigger. There's more events and there's more event organizers. And I think there's possibly more events that exist just to raise money for charity, whereas you don't tend to see that quite as much here. But then, I mean, I've never really looked at the numbers, and it may just be that there's five times more in Australia, which sure. is a correlated population difference.
So. Yeah. You kind of mentioned the proliferation of event organisers. It's a kind of a strange thing about our sport, isn't it? That there's no sort of, well, not a strange thing, but it's a thing about our sport that there's no sort of coordination of events by a central body, as it were. You know, I mean, you've got Athletics New Zealand, which are involved in some events, and they have their club affiliated events. But beyond that, you don't really have, any sort of coordination between events. Do you think, is that something that holds the sport back, or is it just the way it is? That's a terrible question, but I hope you get the gist of what I mean.
I totally understand what you mean. What used to happen, and this is when I first started running, your entry form would have, are you a registered athlete?
Yeah.
I had no idea what that meant at all. And what that meant is, are you an Athletics New Zealand registered athlete, which meant you belong to a club. Mm. And then you started to get event companies like Total Sport come along and decide, oh, we don't need to be affiliated with Athletics New Zealand. We'll just set up our events. And then, I believe at one point in time, if you were an affiliated member and you participated in a non-sanctioned event, you were pretty much struck off and weren't allowed to participate at sanctioned events. And then I think that kind of changed over time because there were more and more of these unsanctioned events. And then more and more companies started up and more events got organised. There's always been fun runs that went, sanctioned or whatever, but there's obviously most events now, there's no central body to govern it. So they'll presumably have their own health and safety plans and whatever insurance is required, but there's no one monitoring to make sure that's happening. So, you as an athlete don't really know, you've just got to trust. And that's why, certain event companies get really good reputations because they put on good events. And people want to keep doing those. And so what happens is some of them might start off doing one or two events and then they see they're doing a good job of it and they're getting people coming along. And so they create some more events and they create some more. And that's what's happened with this new company in Christchurch as well. They started off doing some and then they added a few more and then they've added a few more. So they must be doing presumably well.
Mm. It'd be a hard thing to, sort of my involvement with race directing is very minor, but it'd be a hard thing to not oversaturate a market, especially these days. Hey, where you literally, like you're right, you could fall backwards into a trail running event every weekend for year,
I mean, luckily when I first started running in Auckland, the Run Auckland series hadn't even started yet. That's a five.
No.
The Auckland Half Marathon series hadn't started yet, and so that company running events, they put on eight events in Auckland every year. None of those existed. What else? Total Sport did less. So there were hardly any events in Auckland really at all. And now,
Lactic Turkey.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, he's been pretty around the longest of those. But so there's just so many. And right in Auckland, there's a ridiculous number of events. And now that they're all having to move, dates, there's quite a few conflicts happening. The case of, if you're a trail event and you're at a regional park or something, you've got to try and work with each other and with the council or whoever owns the park or whatever to try and work out who's going to get, to be there on a particular date. So that must be tricky.
I was once, to sound like the old man of this conversation, which I am, I think, the mid-80s, I was involved on the committee of the Papakura Half Marathon organising committee, which was organised by a club. So it was by the Papakura Athletic Club. So that's, you know, I guess where things kind of started from was club organised events, and then it sort of just spawned off into event companies taking over.
Yeah, well, I think part of the problem, I think, is traffic management became a real issue.
Yeah.
And, you know, health and safety. And so it became, clubs are voluntary, obviously. Mm. And so club events are super cheap. You know, like when they would put them on, they'd be like maybe in today's rates, like $10 or something, $20 for half.
Yeah.
And, I mean, there was one, the Glen Eden, they did a run.
The 10-miler. That was famous.
Yeah. They did that for donkey's years.
Yeah.
And it was super cheap. And but unfortunately, traffic management ended up becoming an issue, and they were going to cancel it. And then Native Turkey took it on, and I think they only managed to do it for 1 year. And it just became too expensive. And so that's why you end up with these professional companies doing these events, because it's really hard to just do one event if you don't know all the ins and outs of the stuff. Whereas if you've got your process set up for, you know, how you do all the stuff, it's really easy to replicate it and do another event. And then do another event and do another event. And it'll be the same thing for trail running. You know, it's expensive to create the health and safety plans you need. But once you've got them for one forest, it's going to be more or less the same for another forest or park. So you can reuse that stuff. And you basically distribute the cost out over the course of the year and work out what your costs are. But that's why, you know, professionally organized events are always more expensive than funds that are by clubs or non-profits, because they're all volunteers doing it, so they'll obviously be cheaper.
So what's your story, Chris? I mean, we've talked about this amazing sort of resource that you set up, and your life is organising races. I mean, where did you get your start running? What's your story?
Oh, so when I was I was primary school, I guess. So I would have been like, standard one to standard four. What's that year?
One to four.
Five. Three to six, I guess.
We're terrible at that.
Not in the primers.
We as a family used to go to fun runs with my best friend. His family were runners, and so we'd all go to these things together. And there was one I remember on the North Shore in Auckland called the Roller Coaster Fun Run, and that's because it's up and down and up and down and up and down some more. And I think it ended up in Takapuna. We also done that at least a couple of times. And then there was a run in Woodhill Forest called the Woodhill Forest State Fun Run. Did that about three times. And then I must have done Round the Bays at least once. What else? Yeah, and then kind of like when I got to intermediate school, I managed to make the cross-country team. You had to be in the top 12 to get in the team, and I came 13th. So I got to go to the zone championships and not run. So, I mean, I got half day off school and didn't have to run, so I was happy. anyway, after that, it just stopped. You know, we didn't go to these events anymore. And then I played soccer. I always played soccer. But I wasn't like a runner. And when I was an adult, I joined a social soccer team. And then 1 year, the company I was working for paid for anyone to do any of the events at the ultramarathon. And the 10K at the time went over the Harbour Bridge. And I thought, oh, that sounds pretty cool. I'm sure I can run that far. And you don't get to go over the Harbour Bridge on foot. But I'll do that. And so I did that and really enjoyed it. And then the next year I did the half marathon. And then it kind of spiraled from there. And I got to the point where I was really worried I'd get injured at soccer and I couldn't keep running. So I stopped playing soccer. And in the very last game, at the very end of the game, I was playing goalkeeper and I broke my finger. So it wasn't my foot, but it just went to show, you know, how you can, you know, break stuff pretty easily. I don't think I've played soccer since then.
Wow.
Yeah. But yeah, so then, you know, half marathons lead to marathons, and then I'm like, I'll do an ultra. I'd always liked the idea of doing UTA, which was called the North Face 100 at the time. And then I found out about this race called Tarawera. I thought, oh, that sounds pretty cool. So I did that, and I've done that four times. And that's a really good run.
It is, isn't it? It really had a... It has a mystique, and I remember, you know, the first time that, and I think we sort of were around at the same time, all three of us getting into that, you know, ultra marathons, looking and getting engaged with Tarawera, and it really does have a vibe like no other race, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I don't think so. I wasn't a trail runner. I'd done the Jewel like three times in the like early 2010s. And I never really kind of thought of that so much as being a trail run, because it wasn't in the forest and it's on a lot of farmland and scoria and stuff. And then because I decided to do Tarawera, I thought, well, I'm going to have to do some trail running. So I did the Xterra series in Auckland that year, and then I did the West Coast Marathon at the end of the year. And I just totally fell in love with trail running and just enjoyed it so much more than road running. And then, yeah, I'd never run anything quite like Tarawera, where it was a whole day experience. Apart from like this one training run I'd done, you know, I literally ran for most of the day. And it was just really cool. And you met so many cool people, and the whole day you're to and fro with people and you have a chat with them. And it just, I really, really absolutely fell in love with, you know, running all day with a whole bunch of other people.
What year was the first year you did it?
What year did I do it?
Yeah, what year was the first year you did it?
I think it was 2014 or 2015.
Right. Was it?
So I did it the year, so you know how there was Cycling Lucy and
Yeah, there was the fire course, yeah, and there was Cycling Lucy.
Yeah. So my first year was the year before the fire course.
Okay.
Yeah, so 85K.
Maybe 2012, yeah. And you've done it three other times since, did you say?
Yes. I did the year before the fire course, Cycling Lucy, and then one last year to do 100K from, like, using the normal course.
Yeah. Have you any temptation to do the 100 mile?
Yes, I've been tempted many times, but I just don't think I've got the discipline to train for it.
How do, because you live in fairly central Auckland, but around you there's some little trails and so on, some urban trails that you use quite a bit.
Yes, I managed to go running and pretty much not run on the road at all. So there's a big park down the road from where I live called Waitara Reserve, and I can run it there, and then I can run along a gravel track to Mount Wellington, and then I can basically run out to the like Point England, and there's all these trails, and you can run around the coast, and there's also the park. It's a really, really great place to go urban trail running around here. And like, I've got One Tree Hill nearby, Ricky Basin. There's all sorts of really cool places to go running, and I try and basically run as little on the road part of it as possible.
Yeah, they can. You know, you can always find. I actually quite like the challenge of being able to connect up those little trails and bits of park and stuff, and where I work, you can probably hear the rain, sorry, where I work in Ponsonby, I can manage to connect up little green patches and little trails, and still, even though I'm running in the city, feel like I'm,
yeah,
you know, feel like I'm running on the trails.
Yeah, my trick when I first started trying to do urban trail running was basically to open up Google Maps onto satellite view and look for anything green, and I found some pretty cool places that no one would ever have thought to go running.
I remember Total Sport did this, and they did it over, I think they did it over two seasons, these urban trail night runs, and they were like a 10K or 12K race, and you'd turn up, and they were brilliant. They were so brilliant, you know, smaller field, urban, and...
Like, where would they start from?
There was one on the North Shore in, like... sort of Glenfield, Takapuna. There was one at Albany, in the Royal Albany Trails. They had one at Mission Bay. They were fantastic. They were really bloody good.
Okay, the one that I did was down in Gendawi, and they were awesome. I just don't think they've probably got enough people participating in.
Yeah, that's right. But But this is the thing about the urban trail running, and they were brutal. You know, you sort of go down and your lungs are hanging out by the end of it. Like, it was just fantastic.
Yeah, well, before the COVID-19 thing, I take a group of people every second Wednesday on an urban trail run at nighttime. And it was just, we'd have heaps of fun. And, you know, it was kind of introducing people to places they might not have, you know, known existed.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, Chris, where do you think trail running, obviously we're a trail running show, but so we're more interested in trail running, but running in general, where's it going next? What do you see as the trends?
Interesting question. I think it's probably more of the same. Obviously, with the world we're living in now, it's going to make things a bit different for a while. Which may affect participant numbers or staggering of events. I'm not really sure. The thing is, especially in New Zealand anyway, so many events are relatively small numbered. The biggest trail running events are probably the total sport ones. And then obviously the ultras, like there's quite a lot around the place that have, you know, several hundred people at. I don't think there'll be... I think the biggest thing is there's probably just too many events, which isn't a bad thing for people running them because there's so much choice. I think we're just going to see more of the same, really.
Yeah. Bring it on. Let's get back to racing someday soon, eh?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Hey, just quickly, do you have had you been training for anything this year, Chris? Have you found that you've had to kind of prioritize or replan?
Yeah, no, not really. I did the Coastal Challenge, which is a 33-kilometer run down the coast to Devonport, which was in February or March. I'm pretty sure I did something else, but I can't think what it was. And then I would have entered the Riverhead Relapse, but it happened to fall on the same weekend as the Waterfront Half Marathon, which I work at.
Right.
I would have entered that, but couldn't. Now that obviously we don't have any date for it yet, but... at some point, you guys, you and Sean, will figure out a date, hopefully.
Absolutely.
I didn't have anything else. I had toyed with the idea of doing the Tarawera 100 mile, but you know, I need to actually do a pretty dedicated training program and actually stick to it. I was thinking that's probably a 2-year goal, so not next year, but the year after.
That's a good approach.
And you know, so I get a good solid. I can start getting training done now. I mean, I've got a good solid year, you know, to actually work towards it.
It was incredible, like what, and this is just sort of it's not really a random aside, but sort of being alongside Eugene when he was training for Tarawera, just how deeply baked in it became, the amount of training and the amount, sort of watching, you know, your friend undertake this was incredible. I can't imagine what must have felt like doing it, Eugene.
Yeah, it was, you had to be dedicated, that's for sure. But I was actually surprised by, like, it didn't feel as onerous as it may have seemed from the outside. It's just one of those things of once you get into it, once you commit to it and get into it, then it doesn't feel as heavy a load as it might seem.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm.
Probably good that it didn't rain at all like it's raining now.
It is hosing down. Yeah, so sorry if you can't hear it yet.
I have a theory about the weather at Tarawera that every second year it's crap.
Yeah. Well, this year was supposed to be the second year, but we missed it. Look, Matt, I don't know if you can even hear me because it's so loud here. It's quieting down now. But I was going to say, Chris, now I've been desperately searching back through, and have you? You've already sent in a greatest run ever, haven't you?
Yes, I did.
But
it was a very, very, very long time ago. So when you guys first started the show, I was like, it took me like 7 episodes before I even really knew what you were doing, I think. And then I would listen to them.
That was quicker than we did.
When I got to the end of them, I was like, oh, now I've got to wait once a week for the next one. And then I basically post it up to try and get other people to give you greatest run ever.
That's right.
And my one was, yeah. And I didn't expect you guys to actually read it out on air, so I was surprised.
So have you, given that that's quite some time ago now, have you had a chance to reconsider and, you know, do you want to resubmit a greatest run ever?
Oh, no, it's still the same.
Remind people of what it was.
Okay, so it was the first time I ran the Tarawera Ultra. So I just did to do the 85K, pretty much because I didn't want to. It was back when Tarawera used to go from Rotorua to Kawerau. I decided to do 85 because I thought 100's too far. And the 60K stopped at Tarawera Falls, and I didn't really like the idea of stopping there. And I also liked the idea that it was pretty much a double marathon. So I thought, oh, that's pretty cool. Anyway, I trained really well for it. I was probably the fittest and best trained I've ever been for an event. And it was beautiful weather. And it was just a really fun day, and I really, really enjoyed it. And, you know, I met a lot of really cool people. And I finished strong within the sort of time that I'd expected to finish. And my family was waiting there at the finish line. And it was just a perfect day.
Fantastic. Sounds like the perfect
amazing
day. Yeah. Hey Chris, thank you so much for your time. You've been really generous and with your thoughts as well, and you know, you've got such an insight, so we really appreciate having you on and look forward to going for a run with you again soon someday.
Yes, that would be wonderful.
Yeah. Thanks Chris.
Cheers Chris. Cool. That my the colour races died joke went a little bit flat.
I didn't even pick it up, but I was just too busy thinking I'd react badly if someone chucked a handful of coloured cornstarch in my open mouth when I was running.
There is that too. Maybe I needed to write it down. Maybe it's one of those jokes that only works where you could see it written down.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, anyway. And that thing, you know, that I love that we're interesting critters, and whatever, like you do something as simple as running, we kind of have to flossy it up a bit, and it can go in whole new places. You know?
Make it shiny and new. Yeah,
yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But thank you, Chris. That was really fascinating, sort of traversing all that running is in its many different forms. And it was fascinating, and I really quite enjoyed nerding out a little bit, really.
I did too. And go to Running Calendar. .co.nz or .com.au. Check it out, click the links, go to the people. It helps support the advertisers who help Chris make a living. And
yeah.
He's doing it for the love as well. I mean,
absolutely. Yeah. Right, everyone, keep safe out there. Thank you for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio. Email dirtchurchradio@gmail.com.
Yep, and you can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, and other podcast platforms. You can download direct from the website, dirtchurchradio.com. And if we're not where you want us, let us know. Don't forget to subscribe and rate us. And if you like what you see, please spread the love. It would be great as if many people heard the show as possible. And for that, we need your help. Write in with your greatest run ever.
Well, I said don't, which is, I'm not saying don't write in with your greatest run ever.
It's good. It's reverse psychology.
It is. Don't. Make sure you don't. Yeah, we don't really care. Couldn't give a rat's. No, do that. And also, remember to send in if you've run in horrible, horrible conditions. I would be interested to hear that.
The pictures, more inclement, please. The better. Yep. Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running, for the Faster Spring Energy, CLE. Thank you to our Patreon patrons, and Wild Things. We've got a new partnership with Vert.Run, which we're really excited about. Thanks to our editor, Kieran. And we've got some amazing guests lined up in the next few weeks.
We do. Tune in. Ka kite.
Ka kite.
Thanks, Rigby.